And welcome back. This is part two of our two-part segment on electric motors. We've talked about diesel electrics, we've talked about steam engines, and now we're talking about electric motors in the collection of the Lake Superior Railroad Museum. Thanks for watching. We do appreciate you joining us each and every day for a new episode, and we thank you very much for sharing these with friends, neighbors, relatives, and that cranky old guy down at the corner. We really appreciate it. Thank you very, very much. Now, we're talking about electric motors. Now, we've talked, as I said, about diesel electric engines, and we've talked about steam engines, but this is a completely different technology. And that is the electricity to run the motors that turn the wheels to make the engine go comes from a wire up ahead. And up overhead, that's called a catenary. The pantograph, on the other hand, is that arm that reaches out to come in contact with it. Now, you know, of course, you think about a trolley with the trolley pole, wire overhead, the trolley pole can contact, or in interurban where they had the pantograph up and it was flat against the wire. This is a little different on this one. These are industrial locomotives used in situations where you can't always get that wire directly overhead. That's why the pantograph on this particular one swings out to the side. That way, if the wire's over here, it can reach over and still grab it. Today we're talking about this particular engine. It is the General Electric steeple cab number 307 that was owned by the Hanna Mining Company. General Electric made the bulk of these electric motors for all different railroads and operations. Yes, Westinghouse and Baldwin made a few, but General Electric, you know, live better electrically. They were the pioneers on this and were pushing it. And they mainly had applications in mind where in an urban setting where you have a lot of steam engines and a lot of pollution, well, without steam or coal smoke, the electric is a lot cleaner. Also, another application was through long tunnels. Nothing was worse than going through a tunnel and being the locomotive engineer on a steam engine, and all that steam and smoke and soot came into the cab in a long tunnel because it had no place to go. The other institution that used a lot of these were industrial switching operations, and that caught the attention of the Hanna Mining Company. Hanna Mining Company did an experiment at their Wobegon mine, which is outside of Buell in Minnesota's glorious iron range. And they had a small little electric railroad there. Then that proved successful. So when the Wobegon closed in 1928, they moved that railroad over to a much bigger operation in Keewatin called the Mesabi Chief Mine. And at the Mesabi Chief Mine, that's when they ordered four more of these electric engines from the General Electric Corporation. And the 307 was one of them. You can probably see some pictures anytime you want. We're going to show you some now. This is from Vintage Trains of Minnesota's Arrowhead. It's a C-Vision production, and you can find out more on this from cvtrains.com. This is actual historic footage of similar engines in operation at the Hanna Mine outside of Keewatin. Here you see 305 and 306. 307 is the one in the collection of the Lake Superior Railroad Museum. We don't know if there's any actual footage of it in operation, but they were all from the same general set of locomotives that were bought in 1928. By the way, each one cost about $25,000 new. This comes from a video done by CV Vision. It's called Vintage Trains from Minnesota's Arrowhead, and you can pick it up in our gift shop, or you can also go to cvptrains.com and get it there as well. Interesting the way these worked. Like I said, sometimes they couldn't get to the electric wire to be overhead because they're constantly mining, you see. So as they would dig more and more into the ore body, well, of course, the tracks would have to move over so they could load the trains and take the ore out of the mine. Well, so that they didn't have to move the wire every time they moved the track, they would just have that pantograph hang out to the side like that. Then they didn't have to move the wire as often. What happens when you got to the end of the line, so to speak, or the end of the wire? Well, this big spool here had an extension cord on it. You wrapped around here would be an extension cord that you could take and plug in just like you would your vacuum cleaner, and then the engine could continue to run further out into the mine, into new areas, before they put up the wire. It was really quite ingenious the way all this worked. And of course, it was called a steeple cab. And the reason for that was, it looked like the steeple on the top of a church. This one is preserved here at the Lake Superior Railroad Museum, but you know, you can still see these in operation. There's a little railroad down in central Iowa called Iowa Traction. It runs between Mason City, Iowa, home of the Music Man, and Clear Lake, Iowa. And it is an overhead catenary electric traction railroad. It does switching and does regular, well, just what General Electric had in mind, small little industrial operations, similar to what Hanna did with this particular engine up on Minnesota's glorious iron range. How powerful were these? Well, in the electricity that came down from the wire, that was 600 volts DC. And there was rectifiers, and then it went to the electric motors, which turned the wheels. They really didn't have a horsepower rating. That really wasn't the way they did it. Because it was an industrial, it really wasn't that important. What they really wanted to know was how much iron ore could it pull out? And it could pull 5 loaded side dump cars, each one carrying a little bit more ore, and about 15,000 tons all at one time. So this engine could pull 15,000 tons in 5 cars out of the mine. It ran until 1968. That's when they closed the Chief Masabi mine. Masabi Chief Mine up in the Keewatin was closed in 68. In 1974, this particular motor was donated to the Lake Superior Railroad Museum, where it's on display today. One of 2 electric motors on display at the Lake Superior Railroad Museum. At one time, every mine on the Iron Range hauled ore from the ore body up to the processing plants by rail. Some used steam engines, some used diesel in the early days of the diesel electrics, and some, like Hanna, used electric motors to haul their ore. Now, if you want to see an electric motor in action today, as I said, there's the Iowa Traction Company. There's also, think of the Acela on the East Coast in the Northeast Corridor. Or over in Europe, electric trains run all the time. That's their motive power for choice in Europe for passenger trains, mostly because of the speed. We're going to have another new episode every single day. Remember to leave us a comment starting with, "I want to win," and you could end up with a year's membership to the Lake Superior Railroad Museum, giving away 1 every day this week. And I hope you're the lucky winner. If you're not, you can always go to lsrm.org, that's our website, and there you can join as a member of the Lake Superior Railroad Museum and have all the advantages of membership every single day of the year. We'll have a new episode for you tomorrow. In the meantime, though, remember what you need to do. The hands must be washed, the face must be covered and not touched, have to keep your social distance, and I'm proud of you for taking care of each other.